enfin, it will be shorter than last time.
That's not true. We know that.
It will be a bit repetitive, so I will try to keep it interesting. So last time I explained what we call the fractional spin of an hydrogen atom, for example. And I have shown that the Hartree-Fock theory is known to be exact when you deal with one electron system. But actually, if you are interested in a one electron system but with a fractional spin configuration, so not with one spin up or one spin down, but something between those two, actually the Hartree-Fock theory is no longer exact in that case. So that was what I have explained last time, and I have shown the two most current formalisms in Hartree-Fock, the restricted Hartree-Fock and the unrestricted Hartree-Fock, and I have explained why the unrestricted Hartree-Fock was able to minimize, to reduce the fractional spin errors that we add in the energy. So now I will just take some examples, very simple examples. And the first one will be the case of the hydrogen molecule. So it's something that you can find in most of the textbooks in quantum chemistry. And we will look at the dissociation errors that we have when we try to dissociate the hydrogen molecule, meaning the stretching the molecule, and we will see what we get in the energy in the dissociation limit. So if you want to study the dissociation of the hydrogen molecule, you can do it in restricted Hartree-Fock or in unrestricted Hartree-Fock. And as I have explained last time, in restricted Hartree-Fock, the idea is to use one unique molecular orbital for both spins, so the same one for the spin up and the same one for the spin down part of your electron. And so you will see in all the books that the restricted molecular orbitals of the hydrogen molecule are psi 1 and psi 2, which are on the slides. And they are built from the two atomic orbitals, chi L and chi R, I think. So it's in minimal basis, in a minimal basis procedure, you will have two atomic orbitals. You will localize each one of the hydrogen atoms of the molecule. So L for the left one and R for the right one. And so you will get two molecular orbitals. The lowest one will be psi 1. It will be the one for the ground state. And you will have the other one, psi 2, which will be vacant in this case because we are interested in the ground state. And you see that it's a linear combination of the two atomic orbitals, meaning the ones which are localized on the two H atoms. And so you get those two molecular orbitals in the restricted case. And if you want to do an unrestricted calculation, you will then get two sets of molecular orbitals. So you will have two unrestricted molecular orbitals for the alpha part of your electron, and two unrestricted molecular orbitals for the beta part of your electron. And we are only interested in the lowest ones, meaning because we want the ground state. So you can use for psi 1 alpha and psi 1 beta, you can build them from the restricted solutions of the hydrogen molecule, so psi 1 and psi 2. And you can take, for example, linear combination, with a rotation angle, phi. So if you rotate the restricted molecular orbitals, break the symmetry of the system, and you can have the unrestricted molecular orbitals for the alpha spin and the beta spin. So that's basically the molecular orbitals that you will use in the unrestricted case. So once you have defined your molecular orbitals, you can express the unrestricted Hartree-Fock energy and the restricted Hartree-Fock energy. And if you do so, you will get, here the expression, the energy is expanded in terms of the integrals, the one electron, the Coulomb and exchange matrix elements in the basis of the orthogonal restricted Hartree-Fock molecular orbitals. So if you do so, you will get those different terms for the unrestricted Hartree-Fock energy. And of course, this energy depends on the rotation angle phi that you have used. So once you have this expression, you will try to minimize it in order to get the ground state energy. So you will do the minimization with respect to the rotation angle phi. So that's the unrestricted case. And again, to retrieve the restricted energy of your system, you just have to take a rotation angle of zero, of zero, and you will get the restricted Hartree-Fock energy of the hydrogen molecule, which is 2H11 plus J11. Okay, so that's the two expressions of the energy in the unrestricted formalism and in the restricted one. Okay, sorry. And so if we take a minute to look at the difference between the restricted molecular orbitals and the unrestricted molecular orbitals, we will be able to understand why the restricted formalism is not able to give the correct dissociation of the molecule, while the unrestricted one is able to do things correctly. So here you have just the two plots of the restricted molecular orbitals that you use. So I have explained that we use the same molecular orbital for both spins, and you see that in that case for the left one, it is when the bond length is the equilibrium bond length, so 1.4 for the hydrogen molecule. And you see that this the restricted molecular orbitals is not localized on one particular site. The two H atoms are corresponds to the two peaks, to maximum. And if you stretch your molecule, for example, if the bond length is 10 atomic units, you see that the restricted molecular orbitals is still a linear combination of the two sites. So your electron cannot be on the left one, of the left side or the right side. It is on both atoms. So that's why the restricted Hartree-Fock formalism cannot break the symmetry, the spatial symmetry of your molecule. And if you do the dissociation limit in that case, you will see that the energy that you will get will correspond actually to two hydrogen atoms, but with a spin configuration of one half spin up and one half spin down. So this is not a physical system that you should get if you dissociate the molecule, the hydrogen molecule. And the correct dissociation that you should get is one H atom with, for example, one spin up electron, and the other H atom with a spin down electron. And actually, if you do the unrestricted calculation, you will get this correct dissociation, and that can be explained if you look at the unrestricted molecular orbitals. You will see that for a bond length around the equilibrium distance, you will get the same molecular orbital that in the restricted case. But if you stretch the molecule, so for example, R equal 10 atomic units, in that case, you see that in the unrestricted case, you will see that you will have the molecular orbital of the spin-up electron, for example, will be localized on one of the two sites. and the molecular orbital of the other spin, so the beta spin, will be localized on the other site. So the unrestricted molecular orbital is able to break the spatial symmetry of the molecule and to localize one spin on each atom. So that's why you will get the correct dissociation of this molecule. And so so now if we take the expression of the restricted Hartree-Fock energy of the hydrogen molecule, if you look more specifically on the dissociation limit, meaning if you stretch the molecule, you can rewrite this restricted energy this way. So you will have two contributions, one from the left H atom and one from the right H atom. And you can see that this contribution is the same. It's just one localized on one H atom and the other one localized on the other one. And actually, this contribution to the energy contains an error. So if this energy were exact, you should get only, I will try not to say too much stupid things, but you have one part of the error from each H atom. And actually, you can express this error that you get in the dissociation energy, you can connect it directly to the fractional spin error that I have explained before for the hydrogen atom. And what you will get is that in the dissociation limit, the dissociation error of the restricted energy will be exactly twice the fractional spin error that you have when you have an hydrogen atom with a spin configuration of one half spin up and one half spin down. So this is exactly what I have explained before, the fact that the restricted case gives you one H atom with one half the spin up and half the spin down localized on it, and the same for the other one. So this is interesting because the dissociation error of this molecule, this is something that happens for the strongly correlated systems, and this is a way to explain that the fractional spin error is connected to correlation. I have explained last time that correlation, usually there is no correlation when you have only one electron, but if you work with a fractional spin electron, this is like a new system of two electrons. There is some correlation. Fictitious. I don't know the term. So this is somehow there is a correlation in this system, and this is why we have an error in the energy. So we can link the two processes. Okay, sorry. So if you do the calculation in restricted Hartree-Fock and unrestricted Hartree-Fock, you will get those kind of curves. So you have in red, in a solid line, you have the unrestricted dissociation error. So you see that when you stretch the molecule, the unrestricted Hartree-Fock do possess the right limit, so there is no error. And the restricted one, which is in not dotted, but the other red line, do have a dissociation error, and it is quite large. And in purple, I have just done the calculations using post-Hartree-Fock methods like DFT, and I have used the local density approximation, meaning I have used Slater or Dirac exchange, and I put some VWN5 correlation, and you can see that in that case, if you do DFT with the restricted Hartree-Fock orbitals, you will get the right dissociation limit, but it will happen sooner for the Hartree-Fock case, and if you use the unrestricted No, it's the other one. Sorry. If you use the restricted artifact orbitals plus LDA, you will get the wrong dissociation limit. And if you do the same but using the unrestricted artifact orbitals, you will converge to the right limit, but you will converge after artifact. But what is the most important thing is here is that you can see that the error in the dissociation curves can be linked exactly to the right curve that I have here, which is exactly twice the fractional spin error of an hydrogen atom for various spin configuration, and you can see that there is the correspondence between the dissociation error and the fractional spin error is for the weight 1/2, which is indeed the spin configuration of 1/2 spin up and 1/2 spin down electron on each H atom. So this is the correspondence that I have explained before. Okay, sorry. So that was for the hydrogen molecule, and actually we have done the very similar thing, but for another system, which is the H2+ cation. So this system has the same spatial geometry as the hydrogen molecule, but this time we only deal with one electron, and we will use a spin configuration for this one electron. So we will use, as I have explained last time, an ensemble density, and this ensemble density will have two contributions. So one contribution from the pure spin up density n alpha, which will be ponderated by the weight 1 minus w. And the other contribution in the ensemble density will be from the pure spin beta density with the weight w. So if you create this ensemble density, the case W equals zero will correspond to your H2+ cation, but with a spin up electron. And the case W equals one will correspond to an H2+ cation, but with a spin down electron. And any weight between zero and one will be any spin configuration between those two, but you always deal with a total of one electron. And if you write the unrestricted energy in that case for this system, So if you write the unrestricted artifact energy for this system, the same way that we did for the hydrogen molecule, you can write it with all the Coulomb integral, the exchange integral, etc., of the restricted artifact molecular orbitals. You will get this expression, which will be, of course, weight dependent. So you will have a weight dependent contribution in this energy. And again, the restricted artifact can be retrieved just using the rotation angle of zero, phi equals zero. So you get the restricted artifact ensemble energy of this system, the same way that we did for the hydrogen molecule. Just something important, the case, if you have rotation angle of plus or minus pi over four, this will correspond exactly to having a full separation of the alpha molecular orbital and the beta molecular orbitals, meaning a full separation, the two spins being localized on one of the H atom. So when you have the expression of your energy, if you do the minimization, meaning the finding the right rotation angles that minimize the energy, you will get those kind of curves. Alors, all the curves in solid lines corresponds to the unrestricted artifact energies, but for various weights. So you have the weight zero, which do converge to the right limit. The right limit being minus 1/2, because it your H2 plus cation should, if you stretch this cation, you should get at the end one hydrogen atom with one spin, and another hydrogen atom, but with zero electron. So in terms of energy, you should get the energy of a normal H atom, which is minus 1/2. So you see that all the unrestricted Atrifog energies do converge to the right limit, but not with the same speed. And so that's the unrestricted Atrifog energies. But the restricted Atrifog energies, which are the lines in dotted, I think, you see that for every each weight will get a specific dissociation error, and we see that the maximum this dissociation error is maximum for the weight 0.5 1/2. So that's what we can say. Something else is that if you stay around the equilibrium distance, you see that there is no unrestricted Hartree-Fock. Yes. There is no unrestricted Hartree-Fock solutions actually, but the unrestricted solution actually appears at a precise bond length. And this bond length is called the Coulson-Fisher point. And what we see is this particular point is weight dependent. And we see that the unrestricted Hartree-Fock solution appears the sooner for the weight 0.5. And for the other weight, it will appear for bond length, a greater bond length. And that's because in the case of the weight 1/2, the self-interaction error is larger. So that's why it has to the unrestricted Hartree-Fock energy has to appear sooner, because the error to be compensated is bigger. So we'll see that after. Okay. So it's a bit repetitive, huh? I'm sorry, but if you take as we did for the hydrogen molecule, if you look at the dissociation limit of your restricted Hartree-Fock energy, you can write it this way, meaning with two contributions, one from the left atom and one from the right atom. And actually, you can each contribution can be explained as a fractional spin error for the hydrogen atom. So to do so, you will just you will imagine a fractional spin H atom with not one electron but 1/2 electron, and it's like you want to put this 1/2 electron I don't know the term. To switch 1/2 electron with a spin up, and to switch it to turn it into one half spin down electron. So you can do the same way that we did for the hydrogen molecule. You can create an ensemble density based on 1/2 electron, which will go from a spin-up configuration to a spin-down configuration. And so the weight here is W prime, but actually the weight that you use for the fractional spin H atom is directly connected to the weight that you used for the fractional spin H2 plus cation. The link is just that W prime is W over 1/2 W. And so if you create this ensemble density for your fractional spin hydrogen atom, you can build the energy, the ensemble energy. And you will see that this ensemble energy for your fractional spin H atom with one half electron is the exact energy that you should get, meaning H over one half H plus an error. And this error is the fractional spin error of an hydrogen atom with the spin configuration of 1 minus W over 2 and W over 2. And the idea is simply that the restricted Hartree-Fock calculation always do the same thing, meaning that it takes the spin-up that you have and it distributes it equally on every on all the sites of your molecule. So here we have 1 minus W spin-up and two sites, two H atoms. So the restricted calculation will take 1 minus W over 2 spin-up and it will put it on the two H atoms. And it will do the same for the beta part, meaning we add W spin down electron in our cation, and it will put half of it on each H atoms. So I hope it's clear. I'm sorry, it's really. So this way you can have a similar result that the hydrogen molecule, meaning that you have your H2 plus fractional spin cation, and the dissociation error that you will get in restricted Hartree-Fock is simply two times. Two being the number of sites, the number of H atoms that you have in your molecule. So it will be twice the fractional spin error of your hydrogen atom, but with the configuration, which is half the spin configuration that you have for your H2 plus system. So again, if you plot twice this fractional spin error for the hydrogen atom, you will see that the error that you get in the dissociation energy for every value of the weight will correspond exactly to the fractional spin error of an hydrogen atom with the right spin configuration. So you have again this connection that you can do for all the weight. Okay, sorry. And just finally, just to take a more general case, if this time you are interested on a linear chain of H atoms, so you have N H atoms, so N sites, but you still have one total electron on this chain, and this electron will be separated in a high spin part, meaning 1 minus W high spin part and W low spin part. So if you take this system and if you express the restricted energy as you have done for the hydrogen molecule and the H2 plus cation, you will see that again, you will have the restricted Hartree-Fock energy will not be exact and you will get the exact energy, which is H, meaning one H atom with one electron, and you will have this error, which will correspond actually to the number of sites of your chain times the fractional spin error that you have for an hydrogen atom with this spin configuration. And this spin configuration is simply the spin configuration of your linear chain, but divided by the number of sites. So the restricted calculation always do the same thing. It will look at the number of sites and it will cut all the spin up and all the spin down parts of your electron equally. So divided by n, and it will put this spin configuration on all the sites, and each site will have the wrong energy, and we will provide a fractional spin error, which will be in the total dissociation error of your restricted calculation. Okay, so unfortunately, I don't have any plots for this case. I don't have it yet, so I have to think about it. But it's just that the restricted calculation always applies the same logic, and so you always can explain the dissociation error in terms of the fractional spin error. Okay, so just to conclude, what we should have understand at this point is that the Hartree-Fock formalism it is indeed exact for one electron systems, but not if you look at one electron system but with a fractional spin configuration. In this case, all the methods have some error, fractional spin error, and the Hartree-Fock case actually has the biggest, the larger error in that case. So DFT do have an error, but it is usually smaller than the Hartree-Fock one. And there is other methods that also do have a fractional spin error, but some have smaller errors than the other one. So that's and the idea is that we manage to link the fractional spin error to correlation, and that's the interesting thing in that case. So that's it. Sorry. So it was a bit repetitive. Sorry, but that was what I wanted to show you. Okay. Do you have questions?